Everything in the world is single. All things by a law divine in one another's being mingle. Why not I with time? Hello everyone. Here we will have to see P.B. Shelley's famous poem To a Skylark. Author introduction. P.B. Shelley stands for Percy Bysshe Shelley. Was born on 4th August 1792 at Horsham, Sussex, England. He was one of the major English romantic poets and wrote grotesque lyric and philosophical poem in the English language. His first wife was Harriet Westbrook and Mary Shelley was his second wife. John Keats and Lord Byron were his age fellow friendly poets. He was died on 8th July 1822. About the poem, To a Skylark, written in late June 1820 in London. This poem consists of 21 stanzas made up of 5 lines each. The first 4 lines are metered in triac trimeter, the 5th in iambic hexameter, also called Alexandrian. The rhyme scheme of each stanza is AB, AB, B. There are totally 105 lines in this poem. First stanza. This poem begins with the speaker pointing out a skylark in the sky. He calls out to the bird, not in greeting, but in reverence, "Hail to thee." He refers to the bird as blithe spirit, meaning happiness or joyful, and as epitome of joy. It is less a bird and more an essence of spirit. The poet claims it has come from heaven, or at least from somewhere near it. The bird is pouring a song that is described as an artful song that is not planned or scripted and is therefore all the more beautiful. Second stanza. The bird is not stopping it ascent. It is flying high and has sprung up from earth. The poet compares the skylark to a cloud of fire. It is powerful and unstoppable. Perhaps the bird is returning to heaven from where it first came. Even though the bird is still ascending, it also keeps up its song. Third stanza. The bird is ascending up towards the sun. The sun is most likely setting up for the day, giving the scene greater ambience, as sunrise and sunset have always been seen as magical times. It flies up over the clouds that are closest to sun. Behind the skylark is the power of unbodied joy that does not run out of energy. Its race is just begun. Fourth stanza. At this point in the poem, the bird becomes obscured in the pale purple sky. The sun is truly going down and the light in the sky is changing. It seems to melt around the skylark as it flies. As one casts their eyes to the sky during the day, it is impossible to see stars, but yet one knows they are there. The same thing stands true for Shelley, who senses the bird's presence but can no longer see it. If the bird has become a star of heaven, or perhaps it already was. Fifth stanza. The bird is as keen as the arrows of light that emanate from the silver spear that is the moon at night. The moon is intensely bright, but during the day, once white dawn clears, it is very hard to see. It eventually disappears, but we still know and feel that it is there. Sixth stanza. The atmosphere of the earth can see and cannot see by all. Depending on the time of day is made greater when the bird's voice is there. The bird is as rays of the moon that rain down from heaven. Seventh stanza. The poet compares number of things with the bird. The first is rainbow clouds, which sound pristinely beautiful, but the poet quickly dismisses them as the drops, the rain, or nothing compared to the melody that showers from skylark's presence. Eighth stanza. The poet tells skylarks singing hymns unbidden that have unintended but wonderful consequences. The song of the bird forces sympathy to surface in the minds of those that have not in past heeded the hopes and fears of others. It is actively and morally improving those who hear its song. Ninth stanza. The skylark is said to be like a high-born maiden that is locked away in a palace tower. From there, way above her lover, as the bird is above the poet, she is able to secretly soothe his soul. Her words, just like the bird's music, are sweet as love, and in the case of the maiden, it overflows her bower, her bedroom. Tenth stanza. The poet sees the bird as a glowworm that is emanating golden light in a dell or small valley in the woods amongst the dew. These natural comparisons are those that bring Shelley the closest to relaying the emotion he felt while hearing and briefly seeking the skylark. The bird is scattering its hue of happiness from the sky. It is unbeholden to anyone or anything. Its mind and actions are its own. Its joy is raining down among the flowers and grass. Its essence is becoming a part of everything, not seen but felt. 11th stanza. The sounds, feeling, look of the bird reminds Shelley of a rose that is protected or empowered, but it is own leaves. This protection does not last forever, and warm winds can blow off all of its flowers and spread its scent within the breeze. Quickly, the sweet of the petals is too much even for the winds, those heavy-winged thieves. 12th stanza. The sound of the bird's song is beyond everything. It surpasses everything that ever was before considered joyous and clear and fresh. It is better than the sound of vernal or spring showers landing on the twinkling grass and the beauty of the flowers that rain will have awakened. 13th stanza. He is hoping that the bird, or perhaps it is more apt to call it a sprite, as it embodies an emotion. What thoughts it is thinking. As a poet, he is trying to relate to this flood of art, and has in his life never seen anything that can inspire such beauty, not prize of love or wine. 14th stanza. The song of the bird is described as a hymn sung by a chorus as like a triumphal chant. It suited to all occasions of human life and equally outmatched religious and wartime subjects. The poet tells the bird would be an empty vaunt or a baseless boast. Other songs would clearly be missing something, an element that is impossible to name, but clearly not there. 15th stanza. The poet questioned the bird, "What objects or visions does your beautiful song come from?" He believes in the words of bird, he will have the answer to one of life's greatest questions, how to find happiness. 16th stanza. The speaker does not believe that someone who has ever felt the pain, shadow of annoyance, in fact, these elements of life, can't have come close to touching the skylark. He knows somehow that the bird has experienced the wonders of love without love's sad satiety or disappointing conclusions. 17th stanza. The poet believes that for the bird to be able to produce such a pure sound, it must understand much more about life and death than we mortals dream. This knowledge must be given from beyond, and therefore the beyond is where the sounds must come. 18th stanza. We are only able to view death as before and after, while pined for what we don't have. We are incapable of enjoying anything without remembering our own pain. This is clearest through our sweetest songs, which are not as pure as the skylark's unbridled happiness. 19th stanza. The poet stating that if the human race was able to shake off the hate, pride and fear and all the very human things with which we are born, even if we are able to find a state of being in which we shed not a tear still, we would not know the joy that the skylark does. We would not be able to come near. 20th stanza. He begins by saying that the ability to sing and experience happiness as the skylark does is worth more to him than all treasures that in book are found. It is better than all measures of other delightful sound. 21st stanza. Shelley believes that from my lips a harmonious madness would flow. He would be welcome with his own new abilities. All in all, this piece is about a man's search for happiness. At points, he seems on the verge of desperation, hoping beyond hope that the small bird will answer his biggest question. This poem is relatable for this reason.
Thank you for watching my video.